Then the other thing here is, at the end of the surah, we will learn there's an ayah of sajda. And what do you put on the ground when you make sajda? It's right here. So in the end, the messenger is told, don't be like Abu Jahl, you put your head down now in this dunya. But him, if he doesn't put his head down now, when will we drag his head? Eventually. In the end, the head will come down. Either you bring it down in this dunya, or it will be brought down in the next dunya, in the next life, in the akhirah, but it's going to come down no matter what. You will be brought to your humility. Subhanallah. So, لَنَسْفَعَمْ بِالنَّاصِيَةِ وَالنُّصَاةِ لُغَةِ طَيْئِيَةِ. This is, you know, tribe of طَيْئِيَةِ, طَيْئَة tribe. In their language, this word nasiya was used. قُصَاصُ الشِّعْرِ فِي مُقَدَّمِ الرَّأْسِ. The lock of hair in the front of the head. This word is also used in other places in the Quran. For example, يُعْرَفُ الْمُجْرِمُونَ بِسِيمَاهُمْ فَيُؤْخَذُ بِالنَّوَاصِي, the plural, بِالنَّوَاصِي وَالْأَقْدَامِ. Criminals will be known and recognized by their foreheads, and they will be grabbed by this front lock of hair, and by their feet. So this is another place in Surah Al-Rahman, Allah Azza wa Jalla talks about it. The other thing here is, كَلَّا لَإِن لَمْ يَنْتَهِ. The first part of it is hypothetical. If he doesn't stop, if he doesn't come to, his activities don't come to an end, but the latter part is for sure, لَنَسْفَعَمْ, we will definitely, lam for tawqeed, for emphasizing. Then the noon at the end, لَنَسْفَعَنْ, this is noon of tawqeed also, bin nasiyah. So this is very powerful language from Allah. If he dares to continue, then certainly there will be very sharp consequences. Now, one last meaning of safa'a. Safa'a in Arabic is to grab something and pull it so hard it starts coming out of its roots. Now think about that. What's being grabbed and how it's being yanked and how his face is being dragged. Subhanallah. This is huge, huge ayat. And other places in Quran, Allah talks about أَفَمَنْ يَمْشِي مُكِبًّا عَلَى وَجْهِهِ أَهْدَى. Is the one whose face is in the ground and he's walking like that, is he more guided or the one who stands straight up? And some Mufassirun understood that as the scene on the Day of Judgment. People will be being dragged by their faces and some people will be walking upright. May Allah make us from those who walk upright on that day. Now, the last thing about this, to tie in what we talked about last week. You know, this Abu Jahl, when he came and threatened the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you make salah here one more time and I'm going to crush your neck. I'm going to put my foot on your neck and crush it. That's basically what he said. Then he saw the Messenger make salah again and all his thugs are with him. So he's going to look bad if he doesn't do something. Right? Because he already called him out the time before. So he's not a man if he doesn't go and attack. So he goes to attack the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then I told you last week, he's moving back, flapping his arms, pushing something away, nobody else sees it. And he was asked, what were you doing? And he said, there was this chasm, this ditch, this canyon that showed up before me and him. And there was this vicious creature that was coming at me to grab me. And I was just pushing him back. And then the Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told, بِمَا تُحَدِّثُنِي? What, are you going to talk to me like that? Meaning the Messenger of Allah became strong in his words because Allah had given him this counsel, he's going to be grabbed by his forehead. So the angel was already coming to grab him by the forehead. And he had to run back. Then Allah Azza wa Jal describes in the next ayah, نَاصِيَةٍ كَاذِبَةٍ خَاطِئَةٍ. Three words. This is badal from an-nasiyah. What kind of, why mention this forehead? Allah gives it two adjectives. This forehead that is كَاذِبَة, it's a lying forehead, خَاطِئَة, a forehead that commits a huge mistake. Meaning in his mind, first of all, Allah calls him a liar. Which is an insult, number one, it's humiliating a leader of Quraysh. So you have to understand the political, social ramifications of this kind of language. He's already a leader of Quraysh. The Rasul ﷺ is already the subject not only of ridicule, but also of physical persecution. And now the messenger is given words that are basically not apologetic at all, they're calling him out. Calling him a liar to his face. كَاذِبَةٍ. But what is he a liar about? What the word itself suggests is, he heard the Qur'an, he knew it was true, and he was still lying that it's shi'r or it's this, and he was rejecting it for untrue reasons. So Allah Azza wa Jal already exposed the fact that in deep down inside, Abu Jahl had already accepted that this is the truth. But he refused to humble himself. And this, from the story I told you last time, Akhnas ibn Shuraiq, Abu Jahl, Abu Sufyan, that went to go and listen to the messenger recite Qur'an. He testified it's the truth. He said, we're Banu Amr, we're not going to accept him. Yeah, it's the truth, but come on. If we accept him, his tribe wins forever. We can't have that, our tribe needs to compete. So Allah calls him Kadhiba, this is forehead, Kadhiba. Then he says Khati'ah. And khati'ah is a very interesting word. Khati'ah is a mistake whose consequences one does not know. A mistake whose consequences, you know, you make a mistake, you know, somebody says, yeah, I made a mistake, what's the big deal? If you don't know what the big deal is, you don't know what other things are going to happen because of this mistake, this is a khata. This is one of the meanings of, you know, khata. So Allah calls him khati'ah. In other words, he rejected the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He attacked the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even if he calls it a mistake, he doesn't realize what the consequences are. He doesn't see what the big deal is. And when it gets grabbed, you realize what this mistake was now? So nasiyatin, kathibatin, khati'ah. Now we come back to this life. And Allah Azza wa Jal opens him a challenge. First he said if he doesn't stop, he's going to get grabbed, right? That was the first part. Now it goes further. Allah basically calls him out, subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَلْيَدْعُ نَادِيَ. Let him call his gang. Nadiya comes from, you know, Nadi in Arabic is a public place. And he used to sit in public places and he used to have a lot of people hanging out with him. You know, like a popular gangster and all his sub-gangsters that all want to be, they're low lives, but they only feel cool when they hang out with the cool guy. So they had those guys with him. فَلْيَدْعُونَ. Allah says, let him call his gang. Let him call the people he calls on. Bring them on. Bring your entire posse together. You know, understand, Allah is speaking, but to the kafir, who is speaking? You have to understand this. To a kafir, only the messenger. All they see is this one man, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when he speaks, because they are kuffar, they don't think these are Allah's words. Whose words do they think these are? They think they're his words. He's standing in front of a bunch of criminals that are actually pretty violent, and they've seen battle, and they're tough guys, and he's saying, bring them on. فَلْيَدْعُوا نَادِيَ. Call out his people. Now, after this, by the way, Allah Azza wa Jal then says, سَنَدْعُ الزَّبَانِيَةِ. Then we will very soon call الزَّبَانِيَةِ, which is the plural of زَبْنِيَة. زَبْنِيَة in Arabic means a security guard, a cop. Allah says, you call out your gang, I'm going to call out the guards. Who are these guards? When some of the Mufassirun, like Ash-Shawkani rahimahullah, says, مَلَائِكَةُ التَّعْذِيبِ فِي جَهَنَّمَ لِأَنَّهُمْ يَدْفَعُونَ أَهْلَ النَّارِ إِلَيْهَا. Because زَبَنَا in Arabic means دَفَعَهُ وَرَمَ بِهِ. It means زَبَنَا, to protect something, to guard something, and to guard it with force. And if something tries to get out, you attack it. You give it a beating. Okay. So prison guards, basically. That's one way it's used in classical literature. Qatada radiallahu anhu called it, you know, police, security, soldiers, that sort of thing. Now imagine this scene. It's very easy for us to picture now. It is very easy. On the one hand, you got gangsters, right? You got a bunch of thugs. On the other hand, you got the SWAT team. Is there even a competition? Right? You call out your friends, we're going to call out a horde, the entire military comes out against them. So there's not even a competition. And this calling out, this challenge that was issued to him, and the fact that he ran back, this is how this ayah is interpreted. That Allah Azza wa Jal issued this army against him, right? When he came to attack his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. سَنَدْعُ الزَّبَانِيَةِ. Then at the end, so this was the last passage. Once again, let's reiterate what the passages were. The first was knowledge. Then what kind of person would reject knowledge? Then what kind of behavior does the one who reject knowledge engage in, like Abu Jahl? Then what are the consequences of rejecting or this behavior? What's going to happen to him if he rejects this behavior? And finally, you know, most people who try to practice their deen or give the da'wah more than anybody else, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you could say that the kuffar and their animosity is a distraction to his work. It's a distraction. And it's demoralizing. He's trying to do the most noble work, and here these people are, not only do they use the nastiest language, but they actually physically attack him also. So it's demoralizing. So at the end, Allah Azza wa Jal basically disregards Abu Jahl and starts talking to his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he says, كَلَّا لَا تُطِعْهُ. No, not at all. And كَلَّا is a means by which something is completely disregarded. You know, no big deal. كَلَّا. Don't worry about it. Not at all. Leave it. It's not even an issue. This guy is nothing. Basically, Abu Jahl and his animosity is nothing. It's nothing against you. Don't let it get to your head. Don't stress over it. كَلَّا. لَا تُطِعْهُ. Now, ita'a in Arabic doesn't just mean to follow, it also means to pay attention, to succumb to something, to comply, to yield into something. لَا تُطِعْهُ. Not just don't follow him, don't even pay attention to him. Don't even succumb, don't yield to his pressure. Don't worry about it. Don't be intimidated by it at all. Now, when you're not distracted by that, what should you do? Wasjud. and make sajda. You see, he refused sajda, right? So his forehead gets dragged. He gets another kind of sajda to do in hellfire. But the messenger is told, don't be like him. You make sajda. Watch wasjud. Waqtarib, and you come close. The messenger is told, come close. You know what's beautiful about these ayat? Allah Azza wa Jalla says, wasjud. But he doesn't say, wasjud lillah. Make sajda to Allah. Wasjud lahu. Wasjud li rabbil alameen. No, Allah does not mention himself. Is it obvious that it's about Allah? It is. And this is the second thing Allah teaches us. Very beautiful in this surah. The surah began, allama al-insana ma lam ya'lam. He taught the human being what he couldn't have known. One thing the human being, the criminal needed to know was what? Allah is watching. But here's another very important thing the human being could never have known. You know, there are people who believe in God. They believe in God. They want to please God. They do. But they don't know what to do. They don't know what makes him happy. They don't know how to serve him. They're sincere. They want to serve him. They want to know what to do to be a good person. You'll meet people like that at work. Man, I love God. I really appreciate everything he's done for me. Thank God I have this job. Thank God this, thank God that. They talk about God. They do. But they don't know what to do to make him happy. So when they don't know, what do? They come up with their own philosophies. They come up with their own. The Arabs did this too. They were sincere Arabs even before Islam who wanted to worship Allah. They didn't know how. So you know what they used to do? Some of them used to take all their clothes off and dance around the Kaaba naked, and they thought this makes Allah happy. That's what they did. Why? You ask them why they're doing it? We're trying to make Allah happy. You had other people, you know, a lot of the practices of ignorance and shirk, why do people do them? In the assumption that Allah will be what? God will be happy. He'll be happy with this practice of mine. People slaughter animals, put them in front of statues. Why? Because God will be happy. People had no idea. So now Allah Azza wa Jalla, not the criminal, to the seeker of Allah, the one who seeks to please Allah, they didn't know what to do, so Allah taught, wasjud, make sajda. Don't pay attention to him. I'm teaching you something you couldn't have known. Make sajda to Allah. And it doesn't even have to be mentioned Allah, because he's the teacher himself, so it's clear who should the sajda be to. And by means of sajda, come close, because what do people do with their ignorant practices? They try to come close to Allah. They think these things are going to bring them close to Allah. But Allah told them another way to come close to him. Wasjud waqtarib. Subhanallah. The beginning of the surah was a command. Iqra, read. The ending of the surah is also commands. The ending of the surah is wasjud waqtarib, make sajda, come close. There's also commands. So it begins with a commandment of Allah. It ends with a commandment of Allah. You know what else is remarkable? The two ends of the surah, both of them deal with salah. When do you recite Quran? Iqra. Where do you recite Quran? In salah. Where do you make sajda? In salah. What is the means by which you get close to Allah? When is the slave closest to Allah? In sajda, in salah. So the beginning is worship, the end is worship. The other beautiful thing about this, that how the surah is tied together, is the first part, the first commandment was to read, which is a commandment to seek knowledge, right? Reading enhances your knowledge. But the ending, usjud waqtarib, these are commandments of worship. So there are two things, right? There's seeking knowledge and there's worship. And you know, so there's talab al-ilm and there's qira'ah, that's on the one hand. Then there's ibadah on the other. But what comes first? First you learn, then you worship. There's this gradation between knowledge and then action. And this is something in the entire Qur'an. First you learn, then you practice. Then you learn, then you practice, right? So seeking of knowledge and then practicing that knowledge. Iqra in the beginning, usjud waqtarib at the end. Beautifully tied together, how cohesively the arguments in this surah are presented.